Welcome to the Altium video series on high-speed design issues. My name is Lee Ritchey with Speeding Edge. What I'm going to do with this topic is answer a question often asked about stackups. How can a poorly designed stackup affect signal integrity? So I want to start with what a stackup is. In terms of board design, a stackup is arranging the signal and power layers so that we meet a whole host of goals. Of course, a PCB stackup is composed of copper layers that are some are signals, some are power, some are ground, and sheets of woven glass impregnated with resin. That is the dielectric that holds it all together. In early years of board design, copper layers contained low-speed signals and power and ground traces because things were so slow that we could do that. We didn't need anything special to deliver power. And when I talk about slow here, I'm talking about edges that are like 20 nanoseconds, which by modern standards is very, very slow. As we got more and more complex and power consumption increased, we wound up needing more layers to hold the wire, and then we also needed layers to distribute power. So we wound up with a fairly more complex stackup. Current state of the art is we might have 6 or 8 signal layers and as many or more power and ground layers. I'll show you later on a stackup that's 18 layers that is about half power planes and half signal layers. So what demands we make on modern stackups is much more than it was even 10 years ago. We need to make the stackup deliver a constant impedance for all signals so we minimize reflections. That tends to be where everyone starts. We may need to make sure we control crosstalk, and that will be a combination of how we route and how we separate signals with layers of copper. Multiple supply voltages may be required. My last design had 29 supply voltages in one board. We will see that at this edge rates that we are going at these days, the discrete capacitors that one puts on a board are, quote, too slow to support the fast edges. And so we'll wind up having to build a plane capacitor in to reach power plane pair to supply those fast transients. Now, as we get really high speed, and this is a big issue at 10 gigabits per second, which is not too far off for a lot of you, it is PCI Express Gen 4. It turns out that the glass weave can do something very detrimental to a differential pair, introducing skew, which I'll talk about in a minute. Now, we need to make sure the stackup accounts for all of those. When impedance was the only thing we worried about, most companies had the fabricator do the stack up and calculate the impedance. It was never the right thing to do, but it worked. It worked until these other things came into play. Everything except impedance on that list is out of the skill set of the fab shop, and so needs to be owned by the board designer and the SI engineer and the circuit designer. Managing crosstalk, again, this is interaction of between two signals that are running side by side. We're going to manage that. Excuse me, going too fast there, sorry. Two main variables are height above the nearest plane and the separation edge to edge. Those are the two primary variables here. And so if we let the fabricator do the stack up, what they will likely change is the height above the nearest plane. They won't change the separation, so that's a reason you don't want the fabricator to do that stack up for you. And the SI engineer is going to have to balance height above the plane, edge-to-edge separation, and so on in order to control the crosstalk. And once again, that has to be established before you start doing board layout. Multiple supply voltages. Modern designs tend to have quite a few voltages. Some I've seen as high as 30 voltages are required. In the iPhone, it's 22, if you can imagine something so small having that many. And so how are we going to deal with all those voltages? Well, we're going to have enough power and ground planes so we can supply enough copper to deal with the voltage drop that is associated with the current that is in each of those rails. We need to make sure there's enough power and ground planes to meet the cost and thickness requirements of, and it's become a very complex task doing this. The trade-off back and forth between cost and thickness and all those issues is sometimes the hardest part of the design job I do. The last few designs I've done have had, in fact, the last one had 29 rails and only, I believe it was, 6 plane pairs to distribute all those. So I think it follows that we are going to put multiple rails in some of the voltage planes. And that design, just as a side comment, was a terabit router where all the signals that were differential in the board at 10 gigabits per second. And it was a pizza box sized board. It took about 3 days to come up with the SI rules for routing. It took nearly a month to get the power delivery right. Now, this has turned out for a lot of us to be harder than all the rest. So let's talk about interplane capacitors for the PDS. For at least the last 30 years, the frequencies involved in the edges that switch are too high for bypass caps that we classically put on the board to supply, the classic 0.1, 0.01. They just don't do it. And that, by the way, is where the EMI problem comes from. I talked on another video, and we're going to find out, I'm going to solve that problem with by adding interplane capacitance. So this high frequency charge we need to do the fast switching edges is going to come from the plane, the capacitance formed by the two planes that are close to each other. Why is it better than the discrete capacitors? Well, the Achilles heel of all high-speed power delivery is inductance in the power path, and the plane capacitor has ultra-low inductance, like 2 orders of magnitude less than the capacitors that you mount on the board, and that's why it does that job. So I think it's not obvious, but what I'm implying here, and I'll say it directly, is you can't do the stack up until after you do a power delivery design. And the reason is, until you know how much interplane capacitance each rail needs, you don't know how many plane pairs are required in the stack up. But so once I know what that is, I can set out to design power and ground layers arranged in a way that provides the plane C the PDS needs. Now, here's something that has crept in. It is a major issue with all the internet products that are used to deliver all your signals. When we go to real high speeds with differential pairs, and by that I mean above about 6 gigabits per second, this topic I'm going to talk about can come into play. A differential pair travels over the glass fibers in the weave that's in the board. The diagram in the bottom, or the picture in the bottom right, shows a classic weave, which is called 1080 glass. And you can see that the glass is not uniformly distributed. Well, the isobar of resin is about 3, the isobar of glass is about 6. And so I think you could see from that, I've got a 3.5 mil trace there, which is about the scale of a trace. When the trace is on top of a glass fiber, you expect a high isobar, meaning a low impedance, and in between a low isobar or a higher impedance. So first thing we're going to see is variation in impedance, but the big thing we're going to see is when the dielectric constant increases, the velocity slows down. So we'll wind up where we're on a glass fiber with a slower signal than in between. Well, that's not a big problem if you have only single inner traces, but if you have differential pairs, if they don't follow that same up and down, we're going to wind up with one of the signals getting to the receiver before the other one. And so that is going to produce a difference in arrival time we call skew. Skew can get so bad that the link won't work. We did test boards in 2013 where we had 14-inch long traces running over a glass weave we thought was good. We discovered in 14 inches one of the pair had a difference in arrival time of 62.5 picoseconds. That is 60% of a bit time in 10 gigabits, causing the link to fail. And of course, we're now going at 28 and 56. So you can see that we have to pay attention to glass weave. Wasn't a problem before. It's something that that is a big issue now. We know how to control the problem, but it means we've got to be more rigorous about how we call out the materials in the stack up. And this is a diagram. I'm sorry, it's an eye chart, but this is the minimum information I think you need in a stack up drawing to tell the fabricator what you want. If you look at the fourth column from the left, you'll see I've described exactly the glass weave I want and how thick it is and how much resin there is. And the reason for that, again, is so that I don't have a skew problem. And you'll if you look real close, you can see that between layer 3 and 4, there are two planes back-to-back, separated by only 3 mils. That's one of my interplane capacitors, and you can see several of those going down through the stack-up. So this has all those controls we just talked about. Interplane capacitance, impedance control, a trace width specification, what kind of glass I want. And of course, if you look at that, no fabricator could do this for you. So what I'm saying here is, it might have been okay 10 years ago or 20 years ago to have the fabricator do your stack up. It's not true anymore. And so I would suggest that you can't do less than what I have in this drawing. And I also can tell you that the good fabricators around the world are all used to it. They don't get surprised by seeing a document like this now. Used to startle people. They, why are you being so rigid about all this stuff? Well, I just covered the topics of why you have to do that. So to wrap this piece up, a lot of functions that a stack up performs, only one of which is impedance. The others are crosstalk, multiple power rails, adequate interplane capacitance, minimizing glass weave induced skew, and minimizing cost. None of the items in the last bullet can the fabricator do for you. So it says that you got to take charge of stack up design, and that includes calculating the impedance. That scares people to begin with. It has never scared me, because I've always figured that was my job. The good news is there's plenty of tools out there to help you with this, and there's good information on the materials. Now, I don't want to suggest I do a stack up in my cube and say, here, fabricator, build it. That won't work. If you want something that's manufacturable and you need a team effort that includes these people, the SI engineer, board designer, manufacturing engineer, and at the fabricator, those are all part of the team, and that's what my team looks like when I do a stack up. It's the world we live in now, so if you have not used to doing this, it's time to go get the skills. So I hope that this video had some value to you. If it did, pass it on to your colleagues. Again, I'm Lee Ritchey with Speeding Edge, and we are happy to treat, if you have other subjects you think we should talk about, just let us know, and we'll see if we can make a video. Thanks again for watching.